Mr. Shri Aram Shuri Ji, Shri Rajiv Malhotra, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it's my great privilege on behalf of the Vivekananda Foundation to welcome all of you to a very, very special event, and the event is the release of a very path-breaking book, Indra Yet, by Shri Rajiv Malhotra. Well, friends, in the last couple of centuries, there have been consistent efforts to undermine Hindu philosophical and intellectual tradition. The onslaught has been done in various ways from various fronts, but with a common objective that if India has to be weakened, India's civilizational content has to be eroded. Because India is essentially a civilizational nation. Nation or a state or a nation state, whatever way we may look at it, it draws its essential power from its civilizational unity, from its civilizational content of its nation, lies from that. Amongst various efforts that were made, including, I think, as some of the recent studies and researches have brought about, that how some of the very well known historical facts were suppressed, wrongly interpreted, or misrepresented to the people. But one of the efforts has been to brand an idea. The idea to brand was that Hindu modernism, or the contemporary Hinduism, is actually a farce. It was a contrived thing in which Western philosophical thought was plagiarized, superimposed on an artificial construct by putting some Sanskrit words, couplets, etc. over that, so that it looks that it is a reincarnation of Hinduism, which actually has been there for millennia and centuries, and thereby strengthen the idea of Indian nationalism, to build the Indian nationalism around that. They thought that it was the Western ideas, the Western philosophies, the Western understanding of the political thought in the West, which they thought could be planted here, and its new legitimacy could be given to it by bringing in certain aspects of the Hindu tradition and others. And thereby, a differentiation was sought to be made about traditional Hinduism, about modern Hinduism, about supermodern Hinduism, and all these variations. They found, they wanted to have an icon to pick on that. And they thought that Vivekananda was probably a person who was not any great Hindu saint or a philosopher or a thinker, but essentially was a political, this thing who had a political idea. And he thought that, well, he would be able to use the Indian civilizational tradition and Hindu logic for bringing about a resurgence in Indian nationalism. What is often forgotten is that basic construct in an idea of Hinduism is actually beyond a distinct of time and space. It has never compartmentalized itself in the time segments. It's just like if you take a sapling of a peepal tree and visit it every 1 year, everything about the peepal tree has changed. Its leaves have changed, its roots have expanded, its trunk, its bark, everything has changed. See it after 1,000 years, after 100 years, and probably everything has changed. What is seen today is modern. But what is the real content of that tree, the real genetics of that tree, it continues to be like that. There is no change or variation in that. And unless we understand Hinduism as an organic thing, ever growing, ever changing, ever transforming, it is reinventing itself every day. So actually there is nothing as modern Hinduism. It is a continuity of a flow, continuity of an organic growth which had been continued. And probably the historical experience of the realities of the day did change, did adjust itself to cope with those realities and face those challenges. There have been some scholars and intellectuals who have been trying to give this construct and this interpretation to the modern Hinduism. There is a listing of what the theory of the new Hinduism. This thing by Professor Ram Bachchan, who is a professor of religion in the Olaf College affiliated to Lutheranism. Now, there are some very knowledgeable people sitting here in this room. I do not know how many of you knew about Lutheran Church. I would have told you more about the Lutheran Church had I not been heavily invited that some of my former intelligence colleagues and senior intelligence colleagues are here. They will say it will not be very proper for me to tell about what this organization had been doing in this country for many long years. A large number of disaffection under a very well-planned and calibrated action plan amongst the Dalits to create a disaffection amongst them had been one of the things that it had been undertaking for quite some time. They had been taking and fabricating the evidence to bring about how the atrocities are being done and trying to publicize it and holding seminars, etc., in different parts of the world to project the Indian society as an exploitative society, as a society which has been doing this with the Dalit, with the design, and as a grand conspiracy of the caste society where the Brahmins were the upper caste Hindus and the Dalits. There's a part of, again, you know, it's a larger just thing, a larger of conspiracy, or if I may say, a larger design, of which we are a victim and we have got to be conscious of it. Friends, we are really very lucky today to have Mr. Rajiv Malhotra, who is an eminent Indian American researcher, who has been a public intellectual, a scientist by training, has been a corporate executive, an entrepreneur in telecommunication, a very successful businessman, and who at some stage of his life decided that he is going to put all his intellectual assets, all his financial and economic assets, and devote the rest of his life to the study of for the Indic studies, Indian civilizational studies, comparative religions, and also to rediscover what probably had been lost not only to the people outside but also to people within the country. He founded the Infinity Foundation and he is from the chairman. He is also the governor of Indic Studies in the University of Massachusetts, and he has authored some very, very outstanding books. And I think a good number of you must have seen some of those books. Very outstanding contribution by him to breaking India. I think it's worth reading for all of us to see how India is a part, how India is a victim or a target of a global conspiracy to undermine India's growth to strength, prosperity, and becoming a powerful country in the Committee of Nations. Being Different, Invading the Sacred, Chata, the other books that he had written, and now he has come out with Indira's Net, in which he has demolished point by point this concept of the Neo Hinduism, or those who are trying to put that this Neo Hinduism was a contrived invention of some people to subserve a political agenda or a political motive. We are really grateful that one of the country's best intellectual and intellectual who has got so much of a diversified talent and an interest and a contribution, that Mr. Arun Shuri has been kind enough to come and inaugurate this this book, and I think you now go for the